Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh, wake up, all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen.
The pain.
What you have to say.
At school, sometimes kids do these posters, and they put their hands in paint and they stick their hands on the poster. And she wrote this, it was Father's Day. Dear Dad, because they helped them write this stuff, it was in painting. I really love you, I hope you get well. Two little hands. She knew I was sick. She didn't know why. And I didn't know why. Nobody knew why.
When we were first married, I couldn't touch Angela's face or run my fingers down her spine. I've always been very proud of how she handled all that pain.
It's just hard to even imagine, let alone even think you're going to live through it, because it's just pain. I mean, you ought to be able to take care of that. But trigeminal neuralgia is set to kill you.
When I got sick, and I might as well tell you that story right now, you asked me why I'm impassioned. I'm impassioned because I probably wouldn't be sitting in front of you today if it weren't for upper cervical. I literally got to a point in my life where I suffered so badly, and it's hard, I think, as a human being to say to yourself that if I got to live like this for 5 more years, I don't want to live.
Kevin Broom.
Chantria Harris.
Dr. Cliff Drury.
I was diagnosed with Meniere's disease in 5th grade.
I'm Lori DeGroat.
I used to get migraines since I was 7.
Been practicing successfully for 18 years.
Edward Weller.
I had severe sciatic pain down my right leg.
Bobby Goodman.
And I've been diagnosed with chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia.
Growing up, I developed an irritable bowel.
Growing up as a child, I always was diagnosed with a lazy eye.
Melissa Barnett.
Had that for 7 years.
And I get really emotional about it.
Yeah, I suffer from migraines.
1976, I was in a head-on collision.
I had sciatic pain.
I couldn't get out of bed, could not walk.
And I suffered for many, many years.
Lower back pain.
Every time after I ate, I just have tremendous stomach pain.
It's hard. It's very, very hard because it's almost a hopeless feeling.
Every day, worrying if you're going to make it through the day.
An intense, excruciating, burning pain.
I just have to lay down and turn out all the lights.
Had 2 doctors treat me, no success.
You tend to dictate your life around an illness.
When you grow up and you're blind in one eye, it's different. And
pain, numbness in my fingers and toes, legs.
It's very difficult. And, you know, if you have it yourself, it's difficult because you suffer with the pain. But I think it's almost harder to watch the one you love.
It makes you nauseous, makes you black out at certain points.
It just affected your personal life, your family life.
Actually having all kinds of symptoms like numbness, tingling, not being able to sleep.
Deal with it. Lock yourself in a black room and just used to take as much medication as you can.
You know, the pills and that type of thing just don't seem to work.
The first upper cervical adjustment I had was quite an experience.
Met a man, corrected the vertebrae in my spine, and absolutely changed my life.
I had a herniated disc in my neck. They wanted to operate on it. They told me I'd be paralyzed for life. And after the first adjustment, realized that I was actually going to get well.
Told my son, who is an upper cervical doctor, show me.
It's definitely given my life back, you know, free of pain. And I can eat. I can go about normal living now.
One adjustment, no pain. Sometimes son teaches father.
not many other pains. That's maybe a toothache.
But I regained sight in an eye that I never thought I'd ever have. And it's a miracle.
Did you know that countless patients have had their health restored from upper cervical care? Every breath you breathe, every heartbeat, wiggling of your fingers to eyesight, to emotional feelings, to energy, to pain, to disease, even depression is controlled by your massive computer system, your brainstem. Your brainstem is located at the top of your neck in the donut hole space running from your brain to your body. The strength of your immune system and your capacity to fight off illness is all regulated by the brainstem. We could not sleep, eat, talk, think, or survive without our computer system.
This patient would come in, I would make the Atlas upper cervical corrections, and within about 3 or 4 weeks, the migraines would go away and she would drop out of care. And then a year later, she'd come back in, the migraines are back, we would do the same thing, and I finally started saying, well, you know, if you came in somewhat regularly, I mean, you service your car regularly, why not come in once a month, once every couple months or something, so we don't have to go through this again? And what I would say would go in one ear and right out the other. I walked into the adjusting room, and she had tears in her eyes, and I've never seen her cry before. And I said, what's the problem? She said, well, about 6 weeks ago, when I was driving at night, the glare from the headlights was driving me crazy. I had to pull off the side of the road, couldn't see. And this kept getting worse, so I went to see my ophthalmologist, and he checked me out and he said, well, it must be stress. And she said, I was under a lot of stress, so I figured that was the case. But she said, 2 weeks later, my whole peripheral vision went black. I could see nothing over here, and I panicked. And I went back into the same doctor, and he said, quit wasting my time. There's nothing wrong with you. Now, I'm not criticizing the bedside manner. I'm just saying that he couldn't find out what was wrong with her. She knew something was wrong. So she went to a major university we have in Northern California, and she saw what's called a neuro-ophthalmologist. And this is a neurologist who specializes in the eyes. He evaluated her, and he didn't like what he saw. So he sent her to another neuro-ophthalmologist at an adjacent university. And they came out into the consultation room, and they said, we've got some bad news for you. The blood vessels that feed circulation to your eyes are filled with plaque. The blood vessels are too small for a stent. They're too small for angioplasty. You're going blind. And we feel you've got about 6 weeks till you'll be totally blind. And we want you to enroll in blind school to get used to your new life. Now put yourself in her situation. You're wasting my time, there's nothing wrong with you, and now you're gonna have the rest of your life being blind? So she said, the moment they told me they couldn't do anything for me, I thought about upper cervical chiropractic. She said, you didn't think I listened when you told me that every cell needs to be connected to the brain. We took a new set of x-rays on her, found that the top vertebra was locked in the wrong position. I made an upper cervical adjustment. First week, no real big change. Second week, she said, you know, it's going from double vision to single to double, it's changing. Third week, substantially better. And fourth week, she went back to see the neuro-ophthalmologist for a follow-up. And the doctor was stunned. He said, there's no plaque in your arteries. Your vision is completely normal. Blindness is no longer an option for you. You could believe that I either have such a dynamic adjustment that I adjusted that atlas so hard I knocked that plaque out of the arteries. Or you could believe if you release the irritation off of the nerve fibers in the brainstem and the upper neck area, the body has the potential to reverse the disease process. And I'm grateful for the care she got from her other doctors, but I'm certainly grateful that she got the word about upper cervical chiropractic. What saddens me is how many people out there have problems where they're told it's all in their head, or they're told that there's no answer for you. And that has got to change. And I'm hoping that this upper cervical movement will get so strong that people will realize that the wisdom that made this body to fix itself.
This is Mason. Mason W. Crawford was born June 30th, 2007, weighing in at a yummy 9 pounds. He had what is known as a very common suction-assisted birth. Another common procedure was also used by the delivering doctor, and in the words of Mason's father, Will Crawford, the doctor spun his head around in order to evacuate the liquid from his mouth and lungs. It looks a little rough, but the doctor assured me it was harmless. Mason and his mother were given a clean bill of health when they left the hospital. The first 6 months were fairly routine for this family, with the exception of chronic ear infections. But could the exception have been unknown early signs of what was to come? What is the difference between a general chiropractor and an upper cervical doctor?
This upper cervical doctor had called her and that she had made an appointment and that I could see her. And I said, what's an upper cervical doctor? And she said, well, it's a chiropractor. And I went, oh, goody. Oh, great.
Really, it's not any different than a neurologist and an orthopedist. They're two medical doctors. They just do different things, and they have different instruments and different tools they use. Upper cervical is based upon the premise that when the atlas dislodges and it can't pull itself back in, it can create the vast array of problems. And rather than focusing on adjusting where the pain is located, we focus on getting back to where the epicenter is.
It's the difference between if you ask directions to someplace and they say, head down here and turn left at the tree. That it's the difference between that and you go to MapQuest and you have exactly the right information on how to get there. The information that we give as upper cervical doctors to the body to allow it to heal is so much more specific and so much more precise that because of that, the body is able to take that information and run with it.
An upper cervical doctor usually gets the failures of the medical profession. They've tried everything. And sometimes they come in and they'll say, they don't know what's wrong with me. And they're in terrible shape. And you think, wow, what kind of a problem have we got here? You correct the cause, you correct the vertebral subluxation, and they get well. And you think, what was the problem?
I had an osteopath prior. That's random manipulation. They grab your head and twist it. Physiotherapists were doing that to me when they were trying to get me to get my posture straight. They were just grabbing, the physiotherapist had my head in his arm and was doing this. That's gross manipulation. What upper cervical specific chiropractors do is not that. They do not do that.
I called them the people that manned the switch. Every one of us has an atlas and an act, all of us do. And most of us, the switch is turned off. And an upper cervical just reaches up there and flips the switch on. And then this breath of life or this innate intelligence that's in our body begins to talk back and forth through all the cells in our body correctly, the way we were first designed to do.
That's the simplicity of it. That's the simplicity of it. And people can't, you know, you can give them the garden hose analogy that there's a source for the water, and you step on the hose and the water doesn't water the grass, and when you remove your foot from the hose, the water comes out and waters the grass and the grass grows. And it's too simple for them. It's just too simple. There's got to be something more to that. We've got to spray something on the grass. We've got to add something to the ground to make it grow. We've got to intervene in that. And the wonderful thing about the body and the complexity of it is that it's intelligent in itself. It's a self-healing organism. It just doesn't need any interference to its function. And all we do is correct that, and we can expect health. We can expect health.
What we want to see with patients is not adjust them 5,000 times over the life of their care. Our goal is to make a specific correction, unlock the vertebra, put it back in its normal range of motion, and keep it there for as long as possible. It's holding the adjustment that gets people better. It's not adjusting them. It's keeping the interference checked out over a period of time that allows people to heal and repair back to normal state of health.
Only upper cervical doctors have the ability to obtain that one thing, head-neck alignment, brain-to-body communication.
How does it work?
We know the brain controls everything that goes on in the body. So if the brain can't communicate with some part of the body, it's going to get sick. But if the brain can communicate with all parts of the body, we stay well.
If we think about what the brain does for the body, we have to ask ourselves, does it regulate your digestion? Does it regulate your heart rate? Does it regulate your blood pressure? And if the answer to all those questions are yes, then we have to look at how well is that system working.
I sat in on an upper cervical doctor's monthly patient education talk. I describe his talk as a doctor-to-doctor talk. When he finished his talk, he says, "Now, if any of you would like for me to check you for a short leg, well, come on up." I sat there and watched people look back and forth to each other as if to say, "Now, what does a leg check have to do with my problem?" I could see both sides of the street. I could see and clearly understand the doctor's perspective. I could see and clearly understand the patient's perspective. And I said, "Doctor, next month when you give your talk, consider talking at the patient's level of understanding. When you talk at your level of education, what you say goes over their heads." I said, "Don't talk about anything you can't demonstrate. Don't use any terminology that they would not already know the meaning of. Describe how brain health and healing messages leave the brain by way of the brain stem, pass through the neck, down the spinal cord, out over the entire nervous system, to all parts of the body. These messages control everything that goes on in the body. These messages also direct all body healing. Explain how they can develop head tilt and how head-neck misalignment can cause interference at the point where the head and neck join and prevent the brain from sending its healing messages to the body. Explain when the weight of the head is moved off the center of the top of the neck because of head tilt. The rest of the body will begin to compensate for that shift of weight. One shoulder will come down, a hip is brought up, bringing a leg up with it, creating body imbalance, not a short leg." So the next month, I went back for his talk. He incorporated everything that we talked about. What he had said was logical. It made sense. The simplicity of staying well.
Your first visit.
People come in and they do have some fear. The ones that fear the most, unfortunately, who have a preconception, they've been to other chiropractors. Or there's a group that's never been, but they're in so much pain they don't care. That it's not even a question. They just heard that you can help them, and they will almost do whatever you say. Then there's the group that have been to someone and they're apprehensive. And I just look them in the eye and say, "You're afraid of having your neck twisted. They tell me something, you know, I don't want to hear any cracking, or I don't want..." And I look him in the eye and say, "Well, there's none." That's the end of the story.
All the people that get in my office, even if they're referred in, they're skeptical. And I'd expect people to be skeptical about what we do, because what we do is different. And the people that get into my office, I tell them, "Don't expect me to repeat the same darn nonsense that's failed you. I'm not going to treat your symptoms. We're not going to give you anything. We're not going to take anything away from you. We're going to make a specific correction on the atlas vertebra where you have nerve interference. We're going to get that sucker back in position. And when you're going to allow your body over time to ungrow the disease, to retrace back through the degenerative process that's ensued from this problem."
When I examine a patient, I'm looking at muscle tone, leg length, equality, range of motion. I'm looking for symmetry throughout the spine. And as you evaluate that, the most critical area is where the weight of the head connects with the upper neck. From the second segment down, all of the segments pretty much interconnect. There are joints and pedicles, if you will, that interlock. The top segment can do a 360. There's no bony stops. If you will, visualize, stack up 24 dominoes. Put a bowling ball on top. Biomechanically, that's the structure we're working with.
Some people have big bones and little nerves, and most of their problems are going to be structural. Some people have bigger nerves and littler bones, and they're going to have all kinds of neurological and functional complications without the structural. And some people have a combination of both, and the problems will be going both directions.
The examination.
Over the years, various types of scanning instruments have developed. I'm on my fifth generation one, and the one we use right now is an infrared scanner, which actually takes photographs of the back of the spine and produces heat patterns as to whether there's inflammation or not. And this allows us to decide whether a person may have a locked vertebra. When you have a locked vertebra at the base of the skull in the upper cervical area, when the atlas jams, the body ceases to become dynamic. It's not mobile again. So we'll have an area of inflammation that will just be persistent, and it will show up on one of these scans.
The x-rays that we take from the side, the front, and the top, what we're looking for is to see how much forward or backward, how much turning side to side, and how much to the right or the left.
They have to be perfect because they show us how the bones have moved out of alignment. And what I'm looking at on the x-rays is a millimeter misalignment, 2 millimeters.
Now we composite that into a misalignment, for example, that would look like this. That spine misaligned in that direction. So off the x-rays, we measure the size and shape of the structures, and we calculate the exact pathway that that spine had to move into for that misalignment to exist.
He x-rayed me with these precision x-rays that upper cervical professionals use, very precise, and showed me the relationship between my head and neck. It was like this. Head was one side to the right, neck, left neck inflection. Now that's funny. Not funny for me, but the very first x-ray I had with medical doctors, they commented on my left neck inflection, that being the only thing they could see.
Patients will have x-rays taken of their neck, and their physician will say it's completely normal. But you have to keep in mind the physician's looking for tumors, fractures, dislocations, pretty significant, easily seen lesions.
So each misalignment is as individual as a fingerprint, and each one requires a very specific correction.
And he took a number of shots, one to the front, one to the side, one to the top of the head, and said, this is your
atlas and axis. They sound very similar, but keep it straight this way. You know the Greek mythology figure Atlas? Holding up the world? Atlas is holding up your world, the brain. Axis is so called because the head and the atlas pivot around the axis.
Atlas and axis.
So when I went, she took the three shots. A little while later, she invited us in to look at the three shots, and she was right. My head truly was off to the side. In fact, it was even a little forward. And so she said, what we're going to do is work on these two little bones that sit right below your skull. They're really not attached to your backbone. They just float there. And that's what your head rests on, is those two little bones. Called the atlas and axis, the C1 and C2.
The remainder of the spine from the low back all the way up to the mid-neck region has interlocking joints that limit how far the bones can move. But ironically enough, the atlas and axis, the top two, are not shaped the same way. They don't have the same bony locks. And the segments are held in place by muscles and ligaments. And so as a result, it's a more unstable area, and that's of course what gives us a tremendous amount of mobility we have in the neck area.
It's the one that gives us the most motion, but it's also the weakest link, and it's got to be critically balanced. Otherwise, you're chasing a problem you're not going to find the answer to. You can adjust a low back problem all that you want, but if that weight of the head is still off center, the minute they're standing up in a gravitational field, you're going to go back into the same pattern.
Neurologically, you have the most important area in the whole human body. You have the lower brainstem, which is the area neurologically where the fibers from the left hemisphere of the brain and the right hemisphere of the brain cross over. So the right side of your brain takes care of the left side of your body, and the left side of your brain takes care of the right side of your body. Well, all the crossing over of the fibers take place at the brainstem. So you're talking about a vital, vital area. And what we're doing is we're correcting pressure, misalignment and pressure that's interfering with nerve impulses that have to travel from the brain to the body.
Makes a lot of sense.
The procedure.
There are several upper cervical approaches or atlas approaches, and you know, we all recognize that we're all doing the same thing. We're looking at the spine in a sense of balancing that head-neck relationship in a very specific, precise way.
So she said, would you come with me? And I walked with her back into this little room, and here was this little table about this, maybe 8 inches off the floor. And she said, get down on that on your side, and we're going to correct that.
Well, it's possible to transmit a force through the air. It's called sound, and you don't see it. It's possible to transmit a force through liquid. It's called a wave. And it's possible for this little instrument, or my hand, to transmit a force through the fleshy parts to influence the joint without any deep thrusting or dangerous twisting.
If we do manipulation here, that is what I call severe, that means, by the way, manipulation by definition means you go through the range of motion and then you go a little further. That sounds injurious to me. Don't do that. Don't do that. Or the pulling on the head and raising the person up off the chair, that sounds injurious to me too. I don't do that. The bone is out of place, tap it back towards center into its normal range of motion. If it went this way, get over here and tap it back in place.
But because she's a chiropractor, I'm waiting for a snap or, you know, pop. And nothing, but I feel her either brushing it, something. And then she's okay.
It's so sound that our procedures aren't based on what condition that you have. Our analysis of procedures are based on whether or not the bone is misaligned and putting pressure on the nervous system and interfering. So an upper cervical doctor can literally examine a patient, correct them, remove the interference, and not know what it is they have.
She said, come on, get up. She helped me get up. She said, now I want to take another picture. I want to see what your head looks like. Took me back into the x-ray, took another, a post-x-ray, sent Rhonda and I back out to the waiting room, and we're sitting out there. She came walking out, and she said, yeah, look at this, and showed us the negative. And my head wasn't totally on straight, but it had really moved up on top of my axis. And she said, now it isn't 100%, but we're almost there.
The correction.
Probably the best way of looking at what happens with an upper cervical subluxation is when the atlas dislodges, it does this to you. And this is very confusing for your body because your body uses your eyes for equilibrium.
Head is tipped. Gravity is pulling on us. These muscles are tight. These here are stretched out. And what happens is the innate intelligence has to adapt to that. It doesn't like it. So it adapts in the low back.
So the body levels out the head and creates distortions all the way down the spine. So frequently one shoulder will dip and one hip will be higher than the other and one leg will appear shorter than the other.
Now the low back is all tied up tight and there's tension. So this happens, adaptation. I fix this and there's readaptation by muscles pulling.
We found by making the upper correction in the atlas area, the upper cervical correction, we can allow the muscles to reposition and restructure.
And they should let it alone and let that spine correct itself. That's the whole difference. Give the innate intelligence a little time to straighten it up, and it will.
When we make that correction on the spine and open that nervous system and the life starts coming back in that body, all of a sudden they're bigger than the pain is. And it's easy to handle when you're bigger than it is. It's hard to handle when the pain's bigger than you are. Really hard to handle.
So I drove home. And about halfway up the freeway, the ringing in my ears just stopped. And I was actually listening because I was thinking something's not right, because I've got the car noises, right, the rubber on the concrete. And I could hear everything. And the ringing stopped. And my back's feeling much more relaxed. I don't have any pain and tingling stopping. And I got home and I ate something. And it was hardly in. I still had a bit of pain, but there wasn't any excruciating. It wasn't driving me over. But I was very careful not to use the jaw too much. But I was so happy that I picked up my daughter, Holly. We danced. I had like this until, I think it was like 3 o'clock in the morning or something like that. And then she was asleep. I took her up to bed, put her down, and I crashed out. And I don't know, I think it was 12 hours, 15 hours. I'm not quite sure. It was a long time. And I woke up and I felt I was a 21-year-old again. And I'm looking in the mirror, and my head's not like this anymore. It's like this.
Post-correction.
They come back in for checkups to maintain this. Hopefully, when they come back in, say, 4 days, for example, I do the instrumentation, I do the digital palpation of the neck, and I do the leg checks again. Three checks.
Now, once the atlas is put back in position and the irritation is taken off of the nerves, the first thing that happens is the cervical thoracic muscles, the muscles down the shoulder blades, start to let go. And then the muscles in the anterior neck actually start to wake up and start to pull the curve forward. And sometimes you might even think it's swollen glands, and it's not. It's really just the muscles pulling that curve back towards normal. And the curious thing is, when you lose the curve in your neck, you frequently lose the curve in your lower back. And so as your neck curve comes back, your lower back curve comes back. And that's why, even though I only adjust upper neck, the number one condition I see in my office is low back pain. And the number two condition I see is sciatica, the pain down the leg end of the foot. And it responds extremely well by getting that upper neck put in place.
Every movement you make is a nerve from the brain. Everything you sense or feel is the nervous system. The control and regulation and interaction of every body system you have, body chemistry, circulation, digestion, respiration, even cognition, all neurological, all neurologically based. So you put a tension or a distress in that central nervous system like a rubber band around the finger, it just doesn't function correctly. And so when you reduce it, when you take that stress off the nervous system, there's almost always an immediate relief, but it then is keeping it corrected over time that allows people to get over it and get well.
So I want to tell you about a woman who, about late 30s, and she was in over 12 car accidents over 20-year period. She was finally confined to a wheelchair just to be able to get around, to be able to function. She had a bag of medication. We made a correction, checked her nervous system. Her nervous system was functioning better. It was about a week later, this is amazing. This is a miracle story of the body when it's functioning properly and when the body's able to communicate properly what can happen. She said, something's alive inside my body. Like, wait a second, I'm not in pain. I've been in pain every day for years and years and years. This can't be right. Like, what's going on? And she got up and she could walk. Everything wasn't aching. She had more energy. And she came in for her next appointment and ran up the stairs just to test it out. Like, is this really real? And this is the first time she had gone up the stairs in years. She had been in a wheelchair. Now her life is completely changed. No more medications. She's now given us all the bags of medication so we can show other patients that, you know, that's not where health comes from. Health does not come from the outside in. Health comes from the inside out.
You remember Mason. After about 6 months, Mason's motor skills and coordination were better than normal, according to the Crawford's family pediatrician. Soon Mason was getting bored of a stationary play gym, and after about 3 weeks of usage in his new doorway jumper, Mason's dad started noticing something very unusual. Mason's head would suddenly and involuntarily jerk, raising his right arm up in an obviously unnatural way. Surprised and concerned as any parent would be, he wasn't sure what to make of the movement and watched for repeat symptoms.
What's the matter, baby?
In subsequent days, he began noticing it almost every night. In fact, he was afraid to tell his wife right away, hoping it would just go away and he wouldn't have to upset her unnecessarily. Finally, one night at his in-law's house, his wife would get a front row seat to Mason's new behavior. While playing, Mason moved in such a way, causing him to exhibit this odd movement for almost 10 minutes. This important moment was briefly captured on Will's cell phone. The very next day, they took Mason to their pediatrician, where he was given a clean bill of health. They had provided the cell phone footage toward the end of the visit, and the doctor said he would like to refer them to a neurologist. Obviously, the Crawfords were surprised at this contradictory news, since the doctor had said moments ago that he was a healthy little boy. They realized, in all fairness, he was of course just being professionally thorough. The point still stands, the doctor had no idea that upper cervical care was an option. Children.
The mother who brings her son in, 2 months old, screams for 2 hours every night because he has colic. That child is experiencing pain, but also the parents are experiencing pain. It's the anguish of, there's nothing I can do. And they tried everything. And then after the child is adjusted, sleeps like a baby. That's what I love to see. So every day I touch people and they feel better. It's so cool.
Anytime they laid the baby down, the baby cried immeasurably. And I thought, well, this isn't just about the bowel. I now have two parents who have not been able to sleep a night in like 7-8 months. And so as I went through my protocol on how to balance the nervous system and the musculoskeletal system with the Atlas adjustment, of course, their comment was for the first time the baby was able to lay down without screaming, but the spasm was so severe on the right side, it felt like I was hitting a wood surface. It didn't feel like muscle tone at all. And that was likely what was keeping the baby in pain and uncomfortable on their back. And the second visit in, the baby had a bowel movement there on the table. I maybe saw the child for 6-8 visits, and they came back in when the child was probably 3 to 4, was doing great, was still holding the adjustment. But once you set that Atlas, the bowel worked and they've been fine.
We find constipation, we find colicky problems, we find ear infection problems, and all sorts of problems that kids can have trace right back to that Atlas not being in position. And if you watch a kid for a day, they're, you know, jumping in the couch head first and falling off jungle gyms, and kids have rubber bones. But what concerns me is if that child falls and hits its head on the fireplace hearth, or hits its head on the coffee table, something's got to give. And just because you don't see any blood doesn't mean damage didn't happen. And oftentimes you'll find you've got this kid that you're calling it the terrible twos, and it might very well be the terrible Atlas that's giving them trouble.
You need to get children under care. A boy 5 years old came in, and your neck, your cervical spine is supposed to have a nice lordotic curve forward. The face is that way, a nice curve. His was reversed. And between number 2 and number 6, the Atlas was up against the back of the head. It had just gone the wrong way. Well, he was adjusted in January, I believe it was, 3 years ago. And in 8 weeks' time, it went to 17 degrees the other way, a 40-degree switch. Now, this child didn't know that. But he had flu, he had colds, he had antibiotics constantly. He was hyperactive. They'd have put him on Ritalin, like millions of kids are on. And it would have been a shame because you're destroying the child's upbringing.
What about the little girl with torticollis who was headed to surgery?
Yeah, 6-month-old congenital torticollis. She'd been, her whole life, her head was bent over to one side, couldn't straighten up, she couldn't sit up. Certainly couldn't crawl or walk. And they were going to cut the muscle. They were going to cut the SCM, the muscle in her neck that was holding her head over. Her mom found out about us and brought her in. And one adjustment, and she was up almost straight. After, I think, a couple of weeks, maybe 3 adjustments total, she was perfectly normal.
Mr. and Mrs. Brown. Sorry.
That's okay.
They are incredible people. They operated a six cribs in their home, six cribs, taking care of babies that were given up by whomever and were owned by the state, literally. And they had to be crib cases. If they learned to walk, they would not be able to continue taking care of them. And we saw hydrocephalus, cerebral palsy, I mean, convulsions, you know, all the given up children, as you might say. And when they would get a new child in, they would immediately bring them into our office. They got a reputation of being miracle workers by the social worker. They said, I don't know what you're doing, but you people are miracle workers. And they couldn't tell her what they were doing, or they'd have lost their license, but they had to bite their lip and not say anything to the social worker. And yet they were called miracle workers.
It's just awesome working with kids because they respond so quickly. And it's so great to be able to work with a child and know that they're not going to have to suffer the things that other people have suffered throughout mm-hmm. their life, to take care of the cause of that problem before it ever happens.
We both went to Moldova, a former Republic of Russia. And I mean, that everything's life-changing. Everything we do is life-changing. That impacted us. I didn't even have my doors open yet. I mean, my wife was at home getting my clinic set up, so when I got home, I could start seeing patients. But I mean, when you get there and there are just lines, you should see pictures. I mean, it's 20 wide, a block long, people waiting to get checked. The first trip, we split up, and actually we split the team of 20 doctors up into three groups.
That first trip, we saw about 19,000 in the week. Now, on our second trip, we went about a year later, year and a half later, we saw 49,500 in a week, and we saw 10,000 on the last day. I'll never forget, on one, we have a video where there was a girl was 7 years old and had never heard before in her life. When she came in, she was in line, and it's very loud because we've got people going back and forth, and we have a place where we check everybody first to see if they need to be adjusted. Then they get adjusted if they need it, and then we set them back down and we check them again to make sure that the adjustment or the correction actually worked. It shows on the video that the girl walks up, you know, and you can see she's real timid and, you know, kind of scared. The interpreters are telling the patient, you know, here, tell them what to do. Lay down, you know, kneel down here, turn this way or that way. And then you see that girl come up off the table and stand up and look out over all these people and just start, grabs her ears, and you can see just start screaming. The girl had never heard in her life. She's in this noisy auditorium where there's, who knows, probably several hundred people talking and running and doing things, you know, and all of a sudden, boom, she got hearing just like that.
What about mission trips here?
Huh.
In
the United States?
There needs to be.
Yeah, there needs to be. The problem is, you know, we've got, that's what's kind of frustrating with the United States is, you know, when we would come back, we both opened our offices within a month of that first coming back from that first mission trip, right?
Yeah.
And you know, and it was what was so frustrating was, you know, we get up and in Russia and there's a line of patients fighting. Literally, at one time, the place where I was at was a church. Women broke out into a fight. I mean, literally slugging each other trying to get to the front of the line. And then we come back to the United States and there's thousands of people driving by our office every day.
And don't even know we're there.
Yeah.
Chemicals.
Medication or analgesics are primarily designed to deaden nerves. That's their job. And upper cervical chiropractic is aimed at bringing those nerves back to life. And so oftentimes, if a person is medicating and deadening those nerves, a recovery that should take this long oftentimes takes this long.
Well, I was very much in the medical model, and I have a PhD in pharmaceutics, and I did 20 years of research in pharmaceutical science. I take the antibiotics, I took the in every medication for my migraines. There was a time in my life when I was taking Advil prophylactically every day just in case I would get a headache.
On the 11th year, I tripled his medication. And I was calling in for the prescription and the neurologist was, you know, going ahead and authorizing it at the pharmacy. And it was at that point that I knew he was going to die of liver cancer if we continued in this vein.
Well, it was shutting my liver down. They were taking these blood tests and saying, boy, we're starting to do some serious liver damage.
Apparently, by the time I was 7, the symptoms were bad enough that it caught my parents' attention. And so we went from doctor to doctor to doctor, medical doctors, trying to find an answer.
You know, why are we on medications without checking the nervous system first? Why are we taking, please don't get me wrong, there are life-saving drugs out there. There are drugs that can save somebody's life. But if you look at the degree of advertising with medications on TV alone, we're not being told to look at the body to help balance it. We're being told to take another pill, which has side effects.
When I first started discovering about alternative health care, it really felt strange to know that all of this had been going on and I just didn't even know about it, because I was very firmly in, the medical world.
It's a money machine. I mean, medicine is based on two things. It's based on money and it's based on fear. You know, if you don't take that drug, I've had so many patients, countless patients, we've all had them, that the doctor just scares them to death. You know, they want to get off the medication, and yet they say, well, if you get off that medication, So, I mean, it's just they've got such a grasp on the general public that they're afraid to look elsewhere.
The average 18-year-old has seen over 20,000 hours of drug commercials. If somebody told you you're stupid 20,000 times, you start to believe it. So by the time, I was ingrained the same way. We're all brought up the same way, that if you have a health problem or an ailment or sickness, then you take a drug.
Stop the pain.
Trying to help dull the pain.
Me crying out and asking for more.
When he goes
more,
for three days and three nights, you do what you have to do. And drugs at that point was my only alternative. We tried everything. And what I decided, because I was put in the position of being the decision maker at that point. And when your spouse is saying, I'm going to kill myself, then you look for other alternatives.
The doctors gave my parents all these prescriptions, and one of them I know was a painkiller that was double or triple the dose of my grandmother's dosage. And she was bent over almost in half with crippling arthritis.
I don't want people to get the impression that we're anti-medication. I wouldn't go to a dentist without an anesthetic. I wouldn't ask a diabetic not to take insulin. I wouldn't ask a person to have surgery without that. Medication saves lives. What worries me is that we're such an over-medicated society. The United States represents 5% of the world population, and yet we consume 70% of the drugs.
I didn't know anything about what I know now. I was born in a medicine chest. I grew up that way. It's like, can't you take a pill? I didn't understand, but I knew that she was dealing with a lot of pain. Probably never really knew the whole extent of it.
Chemical insults, including medications, alcohol, smoking, stress, those can make it so that you don't hold your adjustments as well. They weaken the ligaments that hold the bones together.
It's funny now thinking about it, because then it was normal to me. I didn't know. I didn't know anything different.
We had a school teacher come in with severe Meniere's disease. It's a horrible affliction. The world would just spin, and in her definition, the world would just spin, and it would just happen. She mentioned that her husband, her ex-husband, is an employee physician for the Medical University of South Carolina, which is one of the most prominent, probably the prominent medical university in our entire state, and that she had been under the finest medical care there was. She was on salt restrictive diets and medications and tried everything. And we explained the importance of this area up here and how it controlled the brainstem and where the nerve fibers cross and the medulla oblongata, and we call it Houston control. It controls the whole body. And when we corrected the upper cervical area, Meniere's disease went away. Well, she had 5 children. She proceeded to bring several of them, got them all under care. One of them, the young girl wasn't having menstrual cycles. Every third to four months, she'd have a menstrual cycle. She brought her in because of severe headaches that she was having. And as we adjusted her and got her corrected, then the menstrual cycles normalized, and the headaches, which we felt were coming from abnormal hormonal menstrual cycle flow, went away. The prominent child that she had had a severe case of insomnia and was falling asleep at school, was having trouble getting through the grade because he literally would fall asleep at school, and after having this corrected, the insomnia cleared up. I got a call from her husband, and he related to me that he had, his condition was allergic rhinitis, which was allergy-type symptoms, and that he wanted to get under care. And about 2 to 3 weeks into the care, we'd seen a small improvement in his allergic rhinitis, the symptoms that he called allergic rhinitis. But he said, I've got to tell you something. He said, something has happened to me, and I can't explain it. And I said, what is it? And he said, well, before I started care, I didn't relate to you that I had a severe case of impotency, and it's been for years. And he said, it's completely 100% cleared up. What did you do? His father was the oldest practicing internist in Charleston, South Carolina at 72. Very respected family. About 3 months later, the wife asked me, has he been referring any cases up here? Because he regularly has cases that they feel medical care is not helping. I said, I haven't seen one. She asked him point blank, why haven't you referred any cases up for upper cervical care? And he said, and their biased opinions were on general chiropractic. I mean, they were very biased. And he broke down the table and started crying, and he said, what would my colleagues think if I referred patients for upper cervical care, and what would my father think?
Tracy and Will, still in anguish, discussed Mason's situation and ultimately confided in Will's mother as well. They decided to try an upper cervical doctor they knew due to a successful diagnosis and treatment given to Will's mother and himself. Mason. This upper cervical doctor assessed Mason, knowing what to look for, and discovered a double misalignment that he felt was most assuredly causing the spasms and pain. Mason's atlas and axis were gently corrected, and after only 3 treatments and a couple of checkups, the problem disappeared. They decided to do a follow-up with their initial referred neurologist, and everything came back completely normal. This was no real surprise for the Crawfords, but hopefully the neurologist might listen and understand what had happened so that he could help others who so desperately need the power of upper cervical. What is the most frustrating or most rewarding aspect of what you do?
I think the most frustrating thing is probably a lack of awareness on the part of the public about what's available. In my world, I consider 3 enemies of progress: ignorance, which is just not knowing; prejudice, which is believing something that isn't true; and superstition, which is something that would keep you from investigating something that might really help you. And so I think the frustrating thing for me within the framework of what I do is the lack of awareness on the part of people in our culture. It's also that in healthcare there are 2 different ideas that most people don't know that they're available. But on the one side, it says you're fundamentally flawed. You're going to have things go wrong with you during the course of your life. You're not going to recover from or get over. You're not smart enough to make your own decisions, so we need to be making them for you. Okay? On the other side of that picture, it says you come fundamentally perfect, and you have the ability to heal and recover from almost everything and adapt anything you can't heal and recover from. But I'm going to empower you to make your own decisions because you're the only one that knows what's true to you ultimately. Right? And so this is called intervention. This is called non-interference. Real simple ideas. Now, if I got a cavity in a tooth, I need an intervention. Okay? But for health in general, I need to find out what's keeping my life from working and get that out of my life.
There was a 10-year-old boy who, his sister and his mother and father are real good patients. And last Thanksgiving, you know, Thanksgiving is Thanksgiving. You say thanks. The family gets together and grandma is there and they're all holding hands at the table and they have to say, what are you thankful for? Each person. It came to that 10-year-old and he says, I'm thankful for Dr. Kuhn. And it isn't just me, it's recognizing that he has his health. He could come in with a flu or a cold and get adjusted and the next day be fine. And he sees his other kids in the classroom all sick and whatever. And he was smart enough to say, I thank you for Dr. Kuhn. I really appreciated that. for a young mind to see the bigness of what, you know, is happening with him. And that's gratifying as can be, of course.
There's a better message, there's a better paradigm, and upper cervical will be on the map soon. You people will know soon. The world won't get no better if we just let it be.